In the previous videos on this playlist, we have seen how with this visual programming interface, we can create relationships between data in the form of, for example, numbers that we can control with a slider and an interface, and the operations that we can do with that data. So for example, multiplying numbers together, adding them, or creating more complex equations to calculate the area, the surface of elements, etc. But why is this important? Well, it turns out that with parametric modeling, the idea is that we can work with parameters to create arithmetic operations, but we can use the exact same logic to work with geometry and to generate three-dimensional form that is derived from a set of relationships between input data, what's typically referred to as the parameters, and the operations that we set as an algorithm to manipulate that data. So how does that work? Well, it turns out that, for example, we can create very simple basic geometry using numerical inputs for the creation of that form. So for example, let's say that I want to create the simplest form of geometry that I can think of, which is going to be a point in three-dimensional space. What would you need to represent numerically a point in three-dimensional coordinates? Probably the only thing that you need is the numbers that represent where that point is in the x coordinate, in the x direction, the y direction, and the z direction, the triplet. So basically, if we are able to create three numbers and then construct a point out of those three numbers, we will have a parametric point, given the assumption that we can control those three parameters of the point. How could we do that in Grasshopper, for example? Well, very simple. I can just create, I can double click and create a number slider. I'm going to say that this is going to go from, for example, minus 10 to positive 10. It's going to have a value of 1, and then it's going to be three decimal numbers. Okay, so that's fine. And this, I'm going to right click on slider and name it X. And then I'm going to copy this and paste it three times. I'm going to rearrange them. This is going to be Y and this is going to be Z. I'm doing this just because I have a little bit of OCD and I like clean order things. All right. So this would be the input parameters. All right. Input parameters of a point, for example, the X and Y and the Z. So these are three numbers that I can control with my slider. All right. And now how can I create a point out of these three numbers? Well, if we go here to the vector tab, this is a little confusing perhaps at first. If we go to the vector tab, we can see that one of the categories is called point. And if we drop the point, we can see that there's a lot of operations that I can do, that I can use to create, to measure, or to deconstruct points even. The first one, the most obvious one, is constructing a point, as you can see from the description, from X, Y, Z coordinates. And if I click here and I drop this component on the panel, you can see that I have this icon that says X, Y, Z turn into a point. And I have three inputs, X, Y, and Z. As we said in previous videos, I can hover over the inputs to notice that it's asking me for X coordinate and that the tiny hex icon indicates that it's a number that this component needs as an input. The same is for Y and the same is for Z. And you can also notice that here the output is the actual point as a geometry object. And you can see that the hex icon is telling me that it's, with that cross, is indicating that it's a geometry object of the form point. So if I now put this one here, control this one here, and excuse me, and I plug the third one here, you can see. And if I double click and I add a panel here, you can also see that I have a point. I have created a point that has three coordinates, 1, 1, 1. And the coordinates are here. But also, and most importantly, you can also notice that in my Rhino viewport, I have now this tiny red cross that represents a pre-visualization of where that point would be in three-dimensional space. Okay. What's very nice is that I have a geometry entity here, but it's controlled by parameters that can change. So this is a fully parametric point only because I can control it with parameters that might change. And therefore, the location of this point will change depending on the input parameters. All right, so this is great, but honestly, I can also have a point here and I can also drag it, where is the gumball? I can also drag it in 3D space. How is this any different than having a point in Rhino? It doesn't really make a lot of sense. What are all the effort? Well, maybe for a simple point it doesn't, but you can get a little more elaborate than this. So for example, let's say that instead of a point, we wanted to create a sphere, all right? A sphere is a surface object. So I'm going to go here to the surface tab. I'm going to go to primitives, and you can see that I have a bunch of simple 3D objects, boxes, cones, cylinders, and spheres. And actually I have four ways of creating spheres, which is kind of cool. So I'm going to leave it up for you to explore the four different ways. I'm just going to go here for the simple one, which is a sphere, which if I drop here, you can see that I'm going to read and the inputs. This is a very good practice to do. Let me first read what this sphere needs as data, and then let me see if I can feed it to itself. I feed it. So here on the B, it says that it needs a plane. All right. And then on the R, it says that it needs a radius. Well, for reasons that I will, so for example, for the radius, and you can see that I already have here a visualization of the sphere, which means that, and this is because if I hover over the component, you can see that the base plane input already has a default, which is the world XY plane. All right. And then here under R, you can also see that there's a default value, which is 1 units, which means that this component is already giving me a sphere object centered at 0, 0, oriented with the world plane and with a 1 unit radius. So this is great. I have the sphere in 3D, but what if I wanted to control the sphere a little better? Well, I could just decide that I want to add a new parameter here, which is going to be a number slider. This is going to go from 0 this time because I don't want a negative radius. That doesn't really make much sense. To 10 and with 2 decimals, for example. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to name this the radius and I'm going to plug this in here. You can see that now my sphere is parametric because I can control numerically the radius. But I can also control where the center of the sphere is by connecting the center, the point, to the input base plane. If I do that, you can now see that the sphere is linked to the point that is changing in three-dimensional space. And because this point is changing on over my initial parameters, then the point is controlling the location of the center of the sphere. And therefore, I have full control of where the sphere is in three-dimensional space and its size via the radius. So I have the four parameters that completely define where and how big this sphere is. It's a fully parametric sphere. Now, and this is the magic, this is the core, and this is the magic of why parametric modeling is important and why it's super nice. Because large and large amounts of these relationships can actually generate a fair amount of complexity and form and interesting relationships. All of those can be being controlled by numerical inputs, by parameters, or by input form. And that is the beauty of why parametric modeling is so versatile, and it allows for the variability and the exploration of the parametric space that you're creating. Being the parametric space being the combination of all possible parameters that we can combine together. So let's see other examples. So for example, I want to create a cone. A cone needs a base plane, it needs a radius, and it needs a cone height. All right, so let's do that. This is going to be the sphere. I'm going to pack it all the way here. Let me be a little more, I'm going to take this, I'm going to add right here, and I'm going to add this to the group. So now they're both together. I'm going to move this a little here, and this is going to be my sphere creation, for example. Now I'm going to copy these, and I'm going to paste them a little behind, and I'm going to say my cone is going to have this point here, is going to have this radius, and let me move the point somewhere else. And the length, I'm going to create another component. This is going to be called the length. I'm going to plug it in here, and then I'm going to add this to the group. All right. So now I have a new point. I have two points. One is the sphere one. The other one is the cone one. You can see it here, and I can control the location of this point. I control the radius of the cone, and I can control the length of the cone. All right. One thing I would like you to notice, let's just keep it there. All right. And then this is going to be the cone. Or for example, I may want to create a cylinder, right? Well, the cylinder is going to be pretty much the exact same thing. I'm going to copy the whole thing, and it's going to be the, I'm going to copy here the point. I'm going to pass in these parameters here, and then I'm going to use this point at the center as the center of the cylinder, and then this radius, and then this length. And as I move the cylinder somewhere else, you can see that I now have this cylinder that is also fully parametric. Control absolutely parametrically. Okay. I have the three objects, each one of them independent. Okay. So this that you just saw here is how we create basic parametric geometry. Remember, it's all about defining input parameters, and it's all then about defining the sequence of relationships that lead to the generation of a particular form. In this case, because we have used very basic geometry, it's actually quite straightforward. It's just as simple as creating for the sphere, first creating a point that represents its center. And I've actually kind of skipped through the fact that the sphere takes as an input a plane object. And you can see in the hex icon that this is a plane, whereas we're actually giving it a point object, which is two different kinds of geometry. But the thing is still working, actually. So I will explain why that's the case, why sometimes, depending on a particular conditions, why you can switch different types of geometry, and where and how can you give a particular type of geometry to something that is asking you for a different one. Okay, we will see that in further videos down the road. But in the meantime, this is just how you create basic geometry. We will see in further videos how can we create more complex objects with nerve services and much more complex operations that generate more intricate form and more interesting and elegant, perhaps, geometrical objects. All of them fully controlled parametrically. Now, before we wrap up, in the next video, what we're going to do is I'm going to explain to you actually, now that we have some parametric geometry in Rhino, what happens? So what do we do with this, and how do we bring it out from Grasshopper into Rhino, and what is the relationship between Rhino and Grasshopper? How can we use this and export this somewhere else? So let's take a look at that on the next video. Thanks a lot.